الحمد لله وكفى وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل إن كنتم تحبون الله فاتبعوني يحببكم الله ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم وقال الله تعالى في مقام آخر وما آتاكم الرسول فخذوه وما نهاكم عنه فانتهوا وقال الله تعالى في مقام آخر لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة لمن كان يرجو الله واليوم الآخر وذكر الله كثيرا سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم. Just before we start, few of the adabs of coming to the gathering, any gathering, is that, especially in a religious gathering which is already under, which is already taking place, is that you come and sit quietly. Saying salam is the gathering is against the adab of the gathering. It's in fact become makruh to say salam when the gathering is already taking place. Similarly, if two people are talking, it is makruh to go and say salam to them because they're busy doing something. They're busy talking with each other, maybe an important discussion, and if you go and actually go in between and try to say salam, it may disturb them. If you go into the masjid, it is makruh to say salam out loud. People are engaged in zikr, people are engaged in the tilawat of the Qur'an. So it disturbs them. When people are reading Qur'an, it is makruh to say, go and say salam to them. When people are engaged in dua, it is makruh to go and say salam to them. So, this is what we have to learn with our mashayikh. That we know it's necessary, it's mandatory to go and say salam, but then we also have to learn as to when to say salam. So this is from the adab of a gathering when it's already taking place, that we come and sit quietly. If everybody you feel is like doing their own, like they're talking with each other, still it's better that you go and say salam. Only when you feel that, you know, it's not any serious discussion happening. If it is just like people are sitting casually, then you can go and say salam. But if there is serious discussion happening, then we should not say salam. Only when you feel that people are done with their discussion, then you can go and initiate salam. Or go to people who you think are not talking with each other, then you can go and say personal salams to them. But not generally if there is some discussion happening. So know that. So idea is that you don't disturb people. Maybe they're engaged, they're focused. So always, especially if you go in the religious gathering, if somebody, for example, somebody's talking, everybody's listening. So just imagine if somebody coming from outside and saying salam out loud, everybody's focus will be diverted to that person. So this is not from the adab to say salam in a gathering when it is already going on. So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He created all of us, and He demands certain things from us. And we have to learn and implement those things in our life. What I said in the beginning is part of that. We need to understand, we need to learn as to what does Allah Ta'ala wants from us. Because sometimes we know things, but we don't know how to implement that. Because it is a possibility that our understanding is wrong of that thing, the way that we understand it. It is quite a possibility that the way that we understand things might be not the right understanding. That is the reason that we go and sit in the company of the ulama and the mashayikh. Ulama teach you the knowledge, and they also teach you the practicality of it, but normally it's the job of the mashayikh to teach you the practicality of it. But one thing is for certain, that Allah Ta'ala wants certain things from us. This is all what our life is about. What our life is about, that what does Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala want from us? To know that, to learn that, and implement that in our lives. So that when it's time to go back to Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, He's happy with us. Unfortunately, you know, this is something that we don't think of anymore. We don't think of that, you know, we have a certain purpose in our life. So to teach us as to what does Allah want from us, Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala sent messengers. Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala has sent messengers to every ummah, to every people, every nation. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا لِيُطَاعَ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala says that I have not sent a messenger, but that they be obeyed, they be followed with the permission of Allah. So Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, He sent messengers so that they be followed. Because Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala wanted to teach people. This is also important to understand this thing, that Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala could have sent books. You know, in the past ummahs, Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, the way that He dealt with the ummahs was very amazing. Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala actually sent food from the skies. We don't get food, directly food from the skies, from the heavens. If anybody would do wrong, Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala will sometimes, you know, make it open for people. Sometimes when people would do tawbah, Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala will make it right on their doors that this person has done tawbah. That Allah Ta'ala has forgiven this person. A very famous hadith. That there was a person who actually sinned, and then he made tawbah, and he passed away the same night, and next day it was written on his door that, you know, Allah Ta'ala has forgiven this person. So the way that Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala dealt with the people of the past was very different. So it was a possibility as well that Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala could have just given a book. Right? Go read this book. But book is not enough. Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala has sent a teacher, always sent a teacher with the book. Nobody can learn from the book alone. Because I might write something, and I maybe pass it down to all of you, but everybody's understanding is different. And it is very much a possibility, not a possibility, in fact, for certain, it is that everybody will understand that what I've written is according to his own intellect. It is certain. So that is the reason that Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala sent a teacher along with that. لَقَدْ مَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذْ بَعَثَ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ يَتْلُو عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ Allah Ta'ala said that indeed Allah Ta'ala has done a great favor on believers, that He has sent from amongst themselves a messenger who does what? Who recites to them the verses of the Quran. First of all, as I said, that this was book is number one. So Allah Ta'ala, rather than just sending book, He sent a messenger, a person, a human being, a living being, who recited to them that how it should be recited. So somebody teaching them recitation. And then, وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ And then He purified people, purified their hearts. Because purification of the heart is absolutely necessary in order to understand the Sharia. So then He also sent Him as the purifier of the hearts. A murabbi, a murshad, a sheikh, who purified the hearts of the people. And then, وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ Teaching of the book and the wisdom, teaching of the book of the sunnah, was another task. So recitation is one, and teaching as to what does it mean? What does it mean for all of these verses? What do all of these verses mean? That was a totally different task. Four tasks, recitation is different, teaching of the book is different. So Allah Ta'ala sent human beings, living beings, to teach people as to what Allah Ta'ala wants from people. As to what is the purpose of the lives of the people. Allah Ta'ala sent messengers. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا لِيُطَاعَ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. And we were sent our messenger, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And after the passing away of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it has been the job of the ulama and the mashayikh to take the message, to teach people as to what is the job, what is the purpose of our life. Al-ulama warasatul anbiya. The ulama, the scholars, are the inheritors of the Prophet. So this their job that they have to teach people. But it is absolutely necessary that somebody has a living person, a human being, to teach them as to what is the purpose of their life. Why is a human being necessary? There are many reasons. Just please move forward so that, you know, if people come when they come at the back, they have space. There are many reasons. And we have spoken about a few reasons in the past. But one reason is that it is in the nature of the human beings that they learn through practical examples. You know, I teach people in the madrasa. So to explain to them a certain principle or a ruling, I have to give them examples. And they only understand when I say, okay, for example, scenario A, B, and C. And I give them 1, 2, 3 examples, and then they understand it properly of what I actually mean. And the best of those examples is if you actually show them a practical demonstration. That's why, I mean, people who have gone to school, and most of us have gone to school, you know, in every science subject, along with the theory, there is a practical as well. The teachers actually take you to the lab, and they show you, okay, if you do this, if, you know, this acid is mixed with this base, so this reaction happens. Right, there's always, when people see it with their eyes, then they understand it very, very well. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, "Oh, you are all human beings. So I want you to behave in a certain way. And the ways that I want from you is I'm going to bring those ways into one of my people, and you look at him and you follow the way that he is doing things." And that was also the job of the messengers. That was also the job of the messengers. So messengers actually taught, explained, but they were also the role models. It's not only theory, but also practical. So all that he was teaching, explaining, you know, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this is what it means. This is what Allah Ta'ala wants from you. You pray 5 times a day. You fast the month of Ramadan. This is how the fast breaks. This is how you should fast. This is what you should recite in your prayer. So we're teaching the academics of it. But then he was the role model. He was doing things. Because there are many things that human beings go through. So there are many phases of human beings. A human being has different roles to play in his life. So when he's a kid, he's a kid. Right, he goes to school, he's a student. Then he grows up, and then he has to deal with his parents. Then he grows up, and then he actually starts, for example, learning Quran. Then he becomes an adult, he may be leading his prayers, he becomes an imam, or he becomes a tajir, and he becomes a businessman, or he becomes, you know, a doctor, or he works at some place, or he's a CEO of a company, he's a leader, he's a manager. So he's a father, he's a husband. So there are many roles that he has to play in his life. And then, this life is a test. This life, Allah Ta'ala wants that at each and every single step of our life, we have to behave in a certain way. What to do? So Prophet Allah Ta'ala says, look at this man. The way that he did things, you have to do things exactly the same way. And if you do things the way that he did things, this is what I'm going to accept from you, and everything else will be rejected. Because this is what I want from you. That's the purpose of the messengers. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا لِيُطَاعَ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ.
Allah Ta'ala says that the purpose of the messengers is this, that they be followed, they be obeyed with the permission of Allah. And that is why Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala says, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ اللَّهَ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. That if you understand the purpose of life, which is what? Prepare for the death and prepare for the day of judgment when we are going to meet with Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. If you truly believe that you are going to meet with Allah, and if you truly believe that you are going to be judged on the day of judgment, if you really truly believe in that, then take the messenger as your role model. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. Indeed, in the messenger of Allah, in the messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as a perfect role model for you. He has uswatun hasana in you, in him, for you. For whom? لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ اللَّهَ وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرِ. For those people who have this belief in their heart that they are going to meet with Allah, and they are going to be stood up on the day of judgment. If you really believe in that, then follow this man. He is your role model. If you want that you meet with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a way that He is happy with you, and you are saved on that day, which is a horrible day, which is a very difficult day, follow this man. And Allah ta'ala says that I will become happy with you, I will make you my beloved, I will love you if you follow this man. قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ. Oh, you who believe, you claim that you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you are false in your claim if you don't follow this man. If you truly believe, love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ. Oh, my messenger, my beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tell all of these people that if their claim is true, that they love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then فَاتَّبِعُونِي. Follow me. And if you follow me, that is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then what will happen? يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهُ. Then Allah ta'ala will start loving you. وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ. And Allah ta'ala will forgive you of all your sins. You know, ittiba, fattabi'uni, ittiba is something different from ita'a. Ittiba means following somebody footstep by footstep. Ittiba is whatever he says, you take it without any doubt, without any thinking whatsoever. After that, that's ita'a, obeying. And ittiba is following footstep by footstep. Exactly the way he lived his life, you live your life accordingly. So, oh, you who believe, you claim that your love for Allah is true, then you can only be true in your claim if you follow this man footstep by footstep. This is what Allah Ta'ala wants from us. This is the only way that you will be successful in your life, in this test of life. Follow the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Take his commands, obey them, take his seerah, take his sunnah, follow them. مَا أَتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُ. Beautiful. Whatever Prophet ﷺ gives you, take it. Whatever. مَا أَتَاكُمْ. Whatever he gives you, take it. Whatever he commands you to stay away from, stay away from it. That's it. Full stop. Period. Allahu Akbar Kabir. Without an iota of doubt in your head. Oh, why? It's not for me. It's for 1400 years ago. It's for me and it's for you. This deen is for until the day of judgment. It was not for Sahaba only. In fact, he is the last prophet. He is our prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we need to understand his sunnah. We need to understand his seerah, so that we can follow him footstep by footstep. Because this is the only way that we can be successful in our lives. That is it. Allah Ta'ala says that. That's the only way that you will be successful. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ اللَّهَ وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرِ. You claim that you know that you're going to meet with Allah and you're going to be stood up again on the Day of Judgment. You say you believe in it. Okay, then Okay, here's your role model. Follow him. Footstep by footstep. فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has also said, and you know, he said, تَرَكْتُ فِيكُمْ أَمَرَيْنِ. I'm going to leave with you two things. لَن تَضِلُّوا أَن تَمَسَّكْتُمْ بِهَا. You will never go astray if you get stuck to these two things. What are those two things, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? كِتَابُ اللَّهِ وَسُنَّتِي. The book of Allah and my sunnah. That's the only way of guidance. Anything else, destruction. So we have to look into his seerah. You know this hadith that people often quote? صَلُّوا كَمَا رَأَيْتُمُونِي أُصَلِّي. You pray as you see me praying. It's very common hadith, especially, you know, people who don't even know, but they quote this hadith for some reason. What did Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say? صَلُّوا كَمَا رَأَيْتُمُونِي أُصَلِّي. As you see me praying. So what he is emphasizing on is, look at me. He could have explained it to them, but he wanted people to look at him and follow him. So we need to understand his sunnah. Because unfortunately there are many people who try to follow sunnah, but they follow it without understanding it. And that's where the ghulu comes into the deen. Ghulu means exaggeration. The ghulu comes into the deen. So we need to understand it. And that is why we have to go and sit in the company of the mashayikh to understand what it means. What the sunnah means. You know, we need to understand what he is saying. For example, if we are behind an imam in the prayers, he says Allahu Akbar. Now that Allahu Akbar can be for the takbir tahreema. It can be for raising up from, so going into ruku. It can be for going into the sajda. It can be from getting up from the sajda. But we understand why is Imam saying Allahu Akbar. And then we follow him. Just like that, when Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says something or if he does something, we need to understand that as well. What is the message? And that message has to be learned by going and sitting in the company of a live, living person, which are called the mashayikh of this ummah. It is absolutely important. But we need to follow him. We need to understand it and we need to follow him sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Nothing is accepted without ittiba. Nothing. Everything is rejected. SubhanAllah, this life is very important, my friends. Every single breath that we are taking is a treasure. It's not going to come back. It's the breath that I've just taken is not going to come back to me. Every single moment, I'm getting closer to meet with my Lord. Every single second is getting close to my death. Every single second, my life is decreasing. It's not going to come back. So we have to take care of every single second that we have been given. So if it is done in any other way but the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that's rejected. SubhanAllah, we spend so much time in doing a thing and then that gets rejected. You know, the time is wasted, really. It's gone. The only thing that's accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنًا. In him is your best example. And problem with this day and age is people don't give importance to the sunnah. Unfortunately. I know all what I'm talking about is just a reminder. Everybody knows it. But we need to remind ourselves every once in a while. Because this is the only way that we are going to be successful. People don't give importance to sunnah anymore. How many of us actually knows all the sunnah? And how many of us actually who know the sunnah implement the sunnah? There are people who actually, you know, they shout the slogans of Quran and sunnah, but subhanAllah, they go to the masjid and they don't have the time to pray sunnahs before the dhuhr. They don't have time to pray sunnahs after the dhuhr. And you tell them, oh, it's only a sunnah. Do you know what I'm saying? It's only a sunnah. That is the sunnah. That's the only accepted thing. People have absolutely forgotten about the importance of Sunnah. Sunnah is the only way. Sunnah is the only way to be successful in this life. Bas, that's it. There's no other way. How can we say this is only a Sunnah? That's the only way, my friend. People could, you know, they debate about growing a beard, not growing a beard. And the people who actually, you know, go against it, they say, oh, it's only a Sunnah. Well, first of all, what are you talking about? It's only a Sunnah. Although, you know, it's wajib, the Prophet had ordered it. But people who even say it's only a Sunnah, you know, it's a Sunnah. That's the accepted way. There are two things that you can do. You can either shave your face, or you grow a beard. The only thing that's accepted in the sight of Allah is a Sunnah. So if you shave your face, it's rejected. Similarly, any other thing. You have to drink water. Like everybody drinks water. You can say Bismillah, you can drink it in three sips, which is Sunnah. Or you can stand up and drink it in one go. That's rejected. The other is accepted. You can go and eat. You can stand and eat like animals. The way animals eat, like they're walking and they're eating. Or you can sit, you can say Bismillah, you can eat, you know, and from the front of your plate, small morsels, food. This is accepted, that's rejected. It's not only a Sunnah, it is the Sunnah. We need to understand this. And this is the time, honestly, you know, that this message is forgotten. Which is the message of Sunnah. People don't understand what Sunnah is anymore. Sunnah is the only accepted way. And Prophet ﷺ has actually given us a very glad tidings for this day and age. In one of the hadith he says, مَنْ تَمَسَّكَ بِسُنَّةِ عِنَّ فَسَادِ أُمَّتِي. That whoever gets hold to my Sunnah when the Ummah is in fasad, when Ummah is in destruction, then فَلَهُ أَجْرُ مِئَةِ شَهِيدٍ. For him is the reward of 100 martyrs. Subhanallah, Allahu Akbar. What is the fasad of the Ummah? Fasad of the Ummah is that they actually forget what Sharia is. And when people forget what Sunnah is, this is the fasad of the Ummah. And this is what a glad tidings for all of us, that when this message is forgotten out there, when people don't consider Sunnah as important anymore, if we follow Sunnah, Subhanallah, just by drinking in three sips, saying Bismillah, sitting down, we get the reward of 100 martyrs. Do you know what a martyr is? Going, fighting in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you know, actually going through such a difficult phase. One martyr, not one, not two, not 300 martyrs. Just by sitting and drinking water with three sips after saying Bismillah, and then saying Alhamdulillah after that. 100 martyrs, reward. Allahu Akbar Kabira. You know, Imam Malik rahmatullah alayhi, he used to say that Sunnah is like the ship of Nuh alayhi salam. Whoever has, who sits in the ship, who rides the ship, he said, otherwise everybody will be destroyed in the flood of the fitna of this time. Imam Mujaddid al-Sani rahmatullah alayhi, he used to say that if you do nafal worship, nafal, extra worship, yourself, without taking a teacher, without taking consulting anybody, just you feel like, oh, I want to pray 100 rakas tonight. He said it will possibly destroy you. Because you're in the morning, your nafs will say, oh, mashallah, what a beautiful thing did you do. You are such a pak man, you are a zahid, that ujab, that takabbur will come in your heart and you will be destroyed. If you do it yourself, nafal worship. He said the biggest mujahidah is that you do according to the sunnah. That's mujahidah. It's not easy, honestly speaking. Because you are actually controlling your nafs in the, you know, you're tying it with the rope of sunnah. You're not letting it go. It's not free anymore. It's very easy to do whatever you feel like, even if it's a good thing. But the problem, the difficulty comes in when you tie it with Sunnah. SubhanAllah, in his Maktubat, in his letter to his Murideen, he writes a beautiful, an amazing statement in one of the answers. He says, to sleep with the intention of the Qailula in the afternoon, to sleep with an intention of Sunnah Qailula, it is better than 100,000 nafal worships at night. That's nafal, that you are staying up all night praying 100,000 rak'ahs. Is saying you sleep in the afternoon. One is staying up all night, other is sleeping, resting in the afternoon with the intention of the Sunnah of Qailula. He's saying that is better. There's no comparison of Sunnah. You know, somebody came to Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullah alayhi, some of his murid, you know, some murideen are ajeeb, they come to death with ajeeb. So, he came and he stayed with him for 10 years. 10 years in his sohbah, in his, at his place. And he say, and he, after 10 years he said, you know, I'm leaving. So he said, okay, jazakallah, but you know, why did you come? You never told me. I came to see if there is any karama in you. Do you do any supernatural things? Do you fly in the air? Do you walk on the water? So I didn't see any karama in you. I don't think you are a perfect sheikh. I'm going. So he said that, did you see in those 10 years, did you see anything in me that was against Sunnah? He said, no. He said, what's a bigger karama than this? 10 years you spend in a Sunnah way. That is the biggest karama. That's the biggest karama. Some people can sit on the sofa, please. Elderly people or people who have issues with the back, please, you know, please sit on the sofas. That will create some space here as well. Inshallah. Please. Please, sofa bread, please. Some people, please sit. If any people have issues in the back, please sit on the sofas. It's fine. Osama, please sit on the sofa. Sit on the sofa. Just move. There's a saying in Arabic, it says Al-Amru Fawqul Adab, that if his command is given, that takes priority over adab. Okay, so I'm saying just sit on the sofa, don't feel bad about it. Jazakumullah. So following the Sunnah with consistency is better, because there is nothing like it. There's nothing like it. Right? And subhanAllah, you know, if you look into the Sahaba, that's what they did. And that's why they became the Sahaba. And they got it in the Sohbah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But that's what they were doing. Following the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, footstep by footstep. Footstep by footstep. Because they understood that's the only way that they can be successful. And this is what is demanded for all of us as well. And look into their lives. Look at the lives of our pious predecessors. And I've said it many times again. Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Subhanallah. You know, he loved the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to the extent that, you know, he followed him inwardly and outwardly. He was just a lookalike of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We know that when the hijrah was made to Medina Munawwara, and it was like very early mornings, it was still dark, and Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq and Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they were about to enter Medina Munawwara, and it was a little dark, people could not recognize, and people had not seen the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam before as well. And they could not recognize who is the Prophet, and Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq, they thought that possibly Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq is the Prophet. And he also realized that Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is tired, so they came forward to shake hands, so he actually started shaking hands with everybody. Because very difficult if it's a crowd of, like, say, 1,000 people. You know, to just shake hands with 1,000 people is a very tiring thing. So he said, okay, let me shake hands with that niyyah, with that intention. And after everybody was done, and in the meantime, actually the sun also came out. So he took his cloth, and he put it on the head of the Prophet ﷺ to save him from the sunlight. And then people realize, oh, you know, who is the master, who is the slave. But they were so look-alike. And his heart was like the Prophet ﷺ, very much like. He knew, Prophet ﷺ loved cleanliness. He loved purity. And you know, when they were doing this hijrah, so at a certain point, Prophet ﷺ was tired, so Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq cleaned the floor and he asked him, Ya Rasulullah, please you rest, I'll go and get something for you to eat. He went and there was the shepherd grazing his sheep. He said, you know, can you please give me some milk? It's your sheep. He said, yeah, it's mine. So he said, can you give me some milk? He said, yeah, sure. He said, look at the way that his heart was like the Prophet ﷺ. He said, no. First clean the udders. He cleaned the udders and said, okay, now take out the milk. He took out the milk. And he said, you know, now can you please cover it with, he took his cloth and he covered it. Covered the bowl with his cloth and then took it to the Prophet ﷺ. This was his heart. Soft, gentle. In it, just like the Prophet ﷺ was crying all night in his prayers. You know, when Prophet ﷺ was sick at the time of, near the time of his death. So, he said ﷺ to Sayyidina Aisha radiallahu ta'ala, now go and tell Sayyidina Abu Bakr that he should lead the prayers. I cannot come to the masjid because of my weakness. So she said, what did she say? She said, Ya Rasulallah, he cannot lead the prayers. Because once he starts reciting the Quran, he starts crying. People will not be even be able to hear him what he is saying. This was his heart. And just like this softness was like the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. All the characteristics that were in him were the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's characteristics. In fact, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said it, that whatever was in my heart, I put it into the heart of Sayyidina Abu Bakr. He was the role model of the Sunnah. Prophet ﷺ was our role model. He was the role model of who? One who follows the Sunnah. A Ajeeb person. And one of another Sahabi who was the lover of Sunnah, Fanafish, was Sayyidina Abdullah bin Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Allahu Akbar. Ajeeb. I mean, look into his life. It's not like they're not fantasy stories. He was a lover of Sunnah. Once he was going on his camel, and a point came where he lowered his head and then he raised it up again. And people said, "What are you doing?" You know, they were following him. You know, they were taking him as their teacher. He was their sheikh, so they were following him and they asked him, "Ya Sayyidina Abdullah, what did you do?" He said, you know, once I was traveling with the Prophet ﷺ at this point, and there was a tree, and its branch was lowered, and to save his head from that branch of the tree, Prophet ﷺ lowered his head. Even though that tree isn't there anymore, but I just want to follow him, footstep by footstep. Once he was in a journey, he got down from his ride, from his camel horse, you know, sat for a few minutes, and then got up again and started walking again. What did you do? Ya Sayyidina Abdullah. You know what, once Prophet ﷺ was passing through this passage and he wanted to relieve himself, he got from his camel and he actually relieved himself here. So I was going and it was the same path. So I, although I did not have any need to relieve myself, but I just wanted to follow him. Footstep by footstep. They would get extremely upset if somebody had said this, you know, it's only a sunnah, possibly they would have chopped his head. If it was Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala, he would have chopped his head. It's only a sunnah. Somebody said, I don't like, you know, a certain vegetable, pumpkin, that Prophet loved. Somebody said, I don't like it. You know, people like food, they don't like, but somebody just said it, I don't like it. The Sahabi got extremely angry. How come did you say that I don't like it? Don't you know that the Prophet ﷺ liked it? I mean, if you don't want to eat it, don't eat it. But how come did you say that I don't like it? It's only a sunnah. Ajeeb. It is the sunnah. This is the only way that we can be successful in our lives. And our predecessors, you know, our ulama and mashayikh from Darul Uloom Deoband, may Allah have mercy on them. Subhanallah, Mawlana Qasim Nanutvi Rahmatullah Alayhi. You know, once when there were a fight with the Englishmen were going on, so they were after him. So So they were about to come and capture him. So people suggested him, go and hide. Otherwise they will put you into prison. So he said, okay. He actually went into his house and he hid himself for 3 days and three nights. After 3 days and three nights he came out. And people said, no, they're still after you. He said, I looked into the whole Seerah and the only time that I saw Prophet Sallallahu hiding was in the cave of Thawr. That was 3 days and three nights. I cannot hide more than that. Well, Rashid Ahmad Gangohi Sabatullah Ali. Once, in India, or in Lucknow especially, and even some part of Pakistan, this time it said the adab. Somebody came and said to him, adab. It's a part of, it's sort of saying salam. He said, adab. He actually literally scolded him. He said, what do you mean, adab? Don't you know what the sunnah way of greeting? Say, assalamu alaikum. And then our trend is what? Assalamu alaikum. You know what assalamu alaikum means? This is what the munafiqeen used to do. Assalamu alaikum. Assalamu alaikum means death be on you. This is what munafiqeen used to come and say to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, assalamu alaikum. So Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, when she heard munafiqeen say assalamu alaikum, she got extremely upset. She said, wassalamu alaikum wa la'anatullah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, no, don't say anything to them. Just say alaikum. Whatever they are saying to me, just be it on them as well. And this is what our trend is. Assalamu alaikum, assalamu alaikum. You are making dua for the other person. May peace be on you. Wa rahmatullahi, may Allah Ta'ala's mercy be on you. Wa barakatuhu, may Allah Ta'ala's blessings be on you. This is a dua that we make. This is the sunnah. Our Shaykh al-Hind, rahmatullah alayhi, once he used to pray two nawafil sitting after witr, although he was perfectly healthy. So somebody said to him, don't you know that if you pray sitting, then the reward is decreased into half? He said, I don't care if the reward is going to decrease into half, because this is sunnah that Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to pray nawafil sitting after the witr. That's all what I want. Al Mawlana Madni rahmatullah alayhi, once he had a toothache. So somebody brought, what do you call, cloves? Huh? Long? Is what it is? Somebody brought it, four of them. When he brought it, he was a sheikh and he was doing tarbiyah. He said, don't you know that inna allaha witrun yuhibbul witra, that Allah Ta'ala is one and he loves odd? What sort of, student are you? Four? Should have brought three, five. This is how they looked into everything. This was the perspective of their life. Looking at each and every single thing, that if it is according to the sunnah or not. Sayyidina Abdullah bin Mubarak rahmatullah alayhi was a tabi'i, not a sahabi. But Sayyidina Sulaiman bin Jassar rahmatullah alayhi, he said that I looked into the life of Sayyidina Abdullah bin Mubarak rahmatullah alayhi, and the only difference that I saw in him and a sahabi was that he wasn't a sahabi. That's it. We have lost this tradition, my friends. We have lost this tradition. We have to renew this tradition. We have to revive this tradition. We have to do everything according to the sunnah. Each and every single thing. Don't take it that it's only a sunnah. Please. From the time that we get up in the morning to the time that we go back to bed, we have to do everything according to the sunnah. That means that you start up with dua. That you get down from your bed and you put your left foot in the bathroom, in the toilet. And the way that leave yourself according to the sunnah. If you're using toilet papers, to clean yourself, use one or three or five. Even so much so. Then wash properly. Do wudu according to the sunnah. Get out of the toilet with your right foot, sing dua, ghufrana. Recite the dua of wudu, after wudu. Then if you're changing your clothes, if you're taking off, start it from the left. If you're putting on clothes, start it from the right. If you're putting on shoes, start from the right. If you're going out of your house, recite the dua, Bismillahi tawakkaltu ala Allah. Allah Ta'ala's, His protection comes to you. Yeah, all ahadith regarding that. You have to get into the car, start with your right foot. Bismillahi Allahu Akbar. Recite the dua of the car. You know, drive it by reciting du'as. If you're going for Fajr prayer, recite the du'a going for Fajr. You enter into the masjid, enter with the right foot. You know, recite the du'a. And you get out of the masjid, leave with left foot, recite the du'a. Every single thing, when you eat, you know, sit down, wash your hands before that, say Bismillah. You know, eat properly, slowly, from your front. Finish with Alhamdulillah. And I can go on and on. It's not the class to teach every sunnah, but learn sunnahs, implement those in your life. We are losing this tradition. It's not only a sunnah, it's the sunnah. These are the sunnahs. And this is the only way that is going to be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what our life is all about. Don't take it lightly, please. This is a tradition that is lost. SubhanAllah, falsehood is spreading everywhere. They have done all the effort to take their message out. Why can't we take this message out? This is the message. This is the message of success. We even feel bad about it, talking about it to our friends. What's a shame? If they can put big billboards, you know, oh, this is the latest Bollywood movie that has come out. This is the latest Hollywood movie that's come out. Can't we even, you know, tell it to our friends? This is sunnah. Our kids, you know, they know about the movies. They know about Warner Brothers. They know about the latest characters. They know about everything. They don't know sunnahs. SubhanAllah, watch all these kids, Muslim kids, the kids that we know. And SubhanAllah, they're eating. They're walking around, they're eating. The mothers don't even tell them that you have to sit, say Bismillah, and then eat. You give them water to drink and they, you know, they stand up and they drink. Don't even say Bismillah. And you tell, you know, try to tell to people who are close, abhi to bachcha hai, you know, he's only a kid. Come on. When will he learn then? If he's going to learn when he's a kid. You know, there's a proverb that, you know, that the thing that the kids learn is like naqsh kalha, can't remember the Arabic of it, but it's like writing on the stone. Once you write on the stone, that's it, that's permanent. So we have to teach our kids. Don't think they're 2 years old or they're 1 year old. If the 1 year old can say Baba, Mama, why can't he say anything else? If you can teach him, you know, this is the way that you eat, you put the spoon like this, why can't you teach them that, okay, but this is the way that you eat. Say Bismillah. Don't take them as kids. This is the time that they are going to learn. They know everything. They can, SubhanAllah, you know, Ajib, I was in the US and this was a time, I don't know what's the craze now of the kids. I really, you know, my kid is big enough now, but Alhamdulillah, he's never been into all of these characters in any way. But, you know, they were Pokemon, right? That's what they called it. SubhanAllah, they were like hundreds of characters. And I saw kids actually knowing the character, each and every single character. I was thinking, what are they? You know, how can they even memorize all of these characters? Not one or two, right? Many of them, I can't remember how many, but huge. They can memorize all of these difficult, you know, pronunciations of these dinosaurs. I mean, I still struggle with that, you know. I don't want to say T-Rex, but the reality of it is what? I don't know. The long name. They can memorize these long, difficult names. I can't even pronounce it, honestly. If they can memorize all of that, they can memorize these 100 characters of Pokemon, why can't they know the names of the Sahaba? Why can't they know the Sunnahs? Why can't they know, you know, how to live a life? How do you have to eat? How do you have to drink? How do you have to live? How do you have to go and relieve yourselves in the toilet? How do you have to wash yourselves? How do you have to make wudu? How do you have to pray? Why can't you teach the Quran at 4 years of age? If you can recite, like read ABC, what do these nurseries do? They're 4 or 5 years old, 3 or 4 years old, and they know ABCs. Why can't they learn Alibata? Why can't they learn Quran? The thing is that we don't give it importance. That's our issue. It's only a sunnah. We don't know what is a sunnah. Sunnah is the only way of success in our life. This is facade of the Islam. Please don't give it less importance. This is the only way. This is the only way. Right? Be careful about everything. Be careful about Sunnah and everything. And subhanAllah, we care about everything but Sunnah. Ajeeb, you know, people have weddings. They will care about everything. They will start like buying the latest brand shoes, the latest brand bags, with the clothing, you know, the marriage hall. So I want to do it at this place, at Atlantis, whatever. You know, they will care about, oh, you know, we have to call everybody, or my uncle, my aunt, my chacha, my mamu, my puppy. You know, everybody, they will make beautiful cards. Gee, people, it's waste time, waste money on cards as well. Somebody sent us a wedding card, and I thought it's a book. Really, honestly, I thought it's a book. It was like in a box, and there was literally a big book. And like it was in every page, there was something, you know, Mendi on this, and I don't even remember the name of the occasions, but they have like come up with 10 different occasions as to how can they, you know, waste their money in that. And ajeeb, subhanAllah, they care about everything, but if it comes down in the wedding, they all mix, you know, women, they make themselves up with their open, you know, hair, and you know, they're showing themselves off, and it's mixed gathering, people laughing, joking with each other, you know, there's no even arrangement to sit and eat. Literally, if somebody invites you to a wedding party, to a walima, if you take food, you're finding place where can I sit and eat? There's no place, and somebody will bring a chair from the back of the kitchen. Oh, sorry, you know, this is. He will feel possibly that I have, you know, I have issues with my knees. That's why I want to sit. That's the only thing that people will think. They don't know that I want to sit and eat because of sunnah. People are actually act like animals. We are believers, my friends. We have to follow sunnahs. We care about everything but sunnahs. We don't even care about in our weddings, in our occasions, that, you know, what does Allah Ta'ala want from me? What does my Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam want from me? لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنًا لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ اللَّهَ وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرِ. If you want to meet with Allah, if you want to stand over the Day of Judgment, follow Him, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And we care about everything but sunnahs. We should care in everything about sunnahs. And then, I honestly speaking, another thing, that easiest is to follow the outward sunnahs. There's another thing, you know, you tell people about the importance of sunnahs. Oh, I will change myself, I don't feel my heart is in a good state at this point. You know, once my heart will be in a good state, then I will start falling outwardly as well. Well, to change your heart is a lifetime story. It's a lifetime thing. You can never change your heart overnight. You know, all of us are struggling. And we are struggling day and night, and we still slip. We've still hurt people. We still, you know, do things that are bad. This is a lifetime thing. Following the outward sunnahs are the easiest. All what you have to do is to you know, change your wardrobe accordingly. All what you do is to stop buying these blades. All what you have to do is, you know, buy a head cover. All what you have to do is to go and buy a scarf. All what you have to do is go and buy an abaya. That's all what you have to do. It's easiest. Changing your heart is the most difficult thing. But the good thing is that if you follow outwardly with the true intention, with the right intention, because Allah Ta'ala will start loving us then, that Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala will inshallah change our heart. But that's also necessary. Outward is not only, it's not the only thing that we have to follow. We also have to follow the heart of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. We also have to follow the sunnahs of his character as well. You know, some people just follow outward and their character is pathetic. They sin, they shout, they scream, they, you know, impatient, no tawakkul, nothing like that. That's also bad. You have to follow the outward and the inward, but we can start with the outward. That's the easiest. That's the easiest sunnah to follow. So we have to do all of that. And subhanAllah, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I tell you one thing. You know, our amal, angels take our amal of this ummah and they are presented to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam every Monday and every Thursday, I think. Our amal are presented in front of him. This amal of the ummah, angels take it to him. And subhanAllah, just imagine, he looks at the amal of his ummah, and when it will be, and it must have been told to them, you know, your ummah is not following your sunnahs anymore. Just think about the state of his heart. You know, it was a Persian poet, very, you know, he used to write poetry about, you know, love of Allah. And so somebody actually wanted to meet with him. Somebody wanted to meet with him, and he traveled distance. He had that vision, oh mashallah, must have been a very pious man. So he actually traveled to meet with him. When he came to him, and somebody told him he's at the barber shop. So he went to the barber shop, and he saw that actually, you know, he's getting his beard shaved. So he got into a shock. So he said, you know, Rishmi Tarashi in Persian, that you're shaving your beard? So he said, Reshmi Tarasham Bale Dil Kisena Mi Kharasham, that I'm shaving my beard, I'm not hurting anybody's heart. You know, what's it up to you? I'm not hurting anybody's heart. My character, this is what people say, you know. What's the big deal? I'm not doing anything bad. I'm not cheating. I'm not deceiving, you know. He said, I'm just shaving my beard. I'm not hurting anybody's heart. So he said, Bale Dil Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam Mi Kharasham. You're hurting the heart of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What are you saying? That hit his heart. And then he wrote a couplet. He says, Jazakallah ke chasham baaz kar di, mera ba jaane ja hum raaz kar di. You know, Jazakallah that you opened my eyes. And you have opened the secrets of my beloved. So when we don't follow the sunnah, it hurts him. SubhanAllah. You know, when somebody gets hurt from the people where he has expectations from, that's the worst sort of, you know, of the pain. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he actually, you know, we know his seerah. People actually hurt him so much. And the worst of that was Taif. When he went to Taif thinking that possibly those people are going to listen to what he has to say, and these people actually, they made the children run after him and threw stones and so much so that he started bleeding, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he really got hurt with that. Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, years later, he said to Sayyidah Aisha, ya, that you know, I can still feel that pain that I got in Taif. And that has formed the people that did not believe in him. And subhanAllah, for me and you, he actually cried all night. Ummati, ummati, my ummah. You know, once he was making dua, ya Allah. You know, make me meet with my beloved. And Sahaba heard that dua, ya Rasulullah, we are your beloved, we are your ahibba. You know, who are you making dua for? He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, you are my Sahaba, my ahibba, my beloved are those that will come later on in my generations, and they will love me without seeing me, and so much so, that if they have to, you know, sell their children in order to have a didar of a vision of me, they'll be willing to do so. These are my ahibba. Ya Allah, make me meet with my beloved. This only was making dua for us. Every night he was crying. Who was for crying for? He was forgiven. All his sins, if there were none, but you know, he was forgiven. His status was raised. He was crying all night, just like the sound would come out of his blessed chest as if something is boiling. And Sayyidina Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha would, you know, say, Ya Rasulallah, why are you hurting yourself so much? The angel of death is coming to him, you know, your Lord is calling you. Are you ready to go? The first question he's asking, what will happen to my ummah after me? I'm ready, I'm willing, I love to go, but tell me what will happen to my ummah? And Allah Ta'ala says, you know, don't worry, I'll take care of your ummah. And then he says, Ya Allah, Allahumma Rafiq al-A'la, Ya Allah, I'm ready to meet with my Lord, the Most High. This is his state, this is what he was doing for us. And then, you know, our amal, you know, they go to him, Ya Rasulullah, they don't even want to follow you anymore. And subhanAllah, these are the people that he has expectations from. And if you expect from somebody, your husband, your wife, your children, your parents, and if they hurt you, that's the worst form of getting hurt. Right? So we have to follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, my friends. And our problem is that actually we don't, the reason that we don't follow sunnah, that there is no that deep love anymore. Problem is our lack of love for him sallallahu alaihi wasallam. SubhanAllah, the people, you know, the way that the people loved. You know, Mawla Qasim Nanotvi Sahib Rahmatullah Alayhi, when he went for Hajj, you know, he wrote a poem in the love of the Prophet Sallallahu Alayhi Wasallam. I'll just translate it. He said, Ya Allah, that O Prophet of Allah Sallallahu Alayhi Wasallam, that is, he said, there are a lot of hopes for my forgiveness, for my success, but the biggest hope is, he is going on Hajj. He said, the biggest hope is that I can be counted in the dogs of Madina Munawwara. So that when I'm living, I will walk along with the dogs of Madina Munawwara, and when I die, then the worms, the insects of Madina Munawwara will eat me. That's the biggest form of the hope of my Najat, my success, my forgiveness. That's all what I can think of. Somebody came to him and offered him, you know, the green colored shoe. He took it, said Jazakallah, but he put it on the shelf. He said, it's the best, you know, beautiful, it's very expensive. Why did you put it on the shelf? Why didn't you wear it? He said, you know, I know I can wear it, but you know, I feel that it is the color of the tomb of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. I don't really like wearing it. And when I see them in Gangohi Sahib Rahmatullah Alayhi, somebody came back from Hajj and he offered him 3 dates. 3 dates. When he got the dates, he put those 3 dates on his palm and he started looking at it as if they were diamonds. So he called one of his students and he said, you know, how many do you think that we have people who are close? And he started counting and he thought, you know, possibly more than 50. He said that, you know, then cut it into equal pieces of whatever number of people they are, and then distribute and give one piece to everybody. So the student said, you know, what will they get out of that small little piece of it? He got extremely angry. He said that it is a date of Madina Munawwara and saying it's a small. How come did you say it's a small? This is their love. SubhanAllah, Al-Mulayah Muhsin Ahmad Madni Sahib Rahmatullah Alayhi. You know, he did not have much. And, you know, his salary was very low, but he really wanted to go to Hajj. And it's written in the books that when the time of Hajj will come, he couldn't even sit properly. He will walk in his house, you know. One day, you know, he raised his hands and he said, Ya Allah, you know, your beloveds, your lovers, what they must be doing right now. They must be in Arafat. They must be in Muzdalifah. He had that deep love. SubhanAllah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted him. It also always happens. When you have desire, your talab, Allah ta'ala checks your heart. And then if you have true sincerity, true talab, true love, Allah ta'ala accepts you. So Allah ta'ala accepted him, and not only accepted him, he not only went to the Haramain, he actually taught hadith in the masjid of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for 18 years. He was called Madani. And you know, normally people would, when they will teach hadith, they will say, Qala qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He used to say, Qala hadha Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He would stand right in front of the rawda, and he would point, Qala hadha Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. SubhanAllah. And it's also written in the books, you know, that those were times when people, you will hardly find people. It's not like these days that you've like millions of people. So at the right before the Hajj, when it will be all dark, he will go and he will actually, you know, wipe the place outside the Rawda with his own beard. Somehow. That's what's missing in us. It's the love. That's why we don't follow sunnahs anymore. So my friends, let's take the message out. Let's start following it. Let's take the message out. This is the message. That's the only way of success. Follow sunnah at everything. Love every sunnah. And follow it. Teach your kids. Teach your kids sunnah, please. You know, just, that's, if they get busy in learning Quran, learning sunnah, implementing them, you play with them. With the sunnah, with the niyyah of the sunnah, the Prophet ﷺ played with the kids. You love them, you kiss them on their cheek, you know, you pat them on their head with the intention of sunnah. You'll get reward, and this is how you will bring that love of Allah and His Messenger in their hearts. And honestly speaking, they will not have time for anything else. Teach your kids sunnah. Teach them the love of Allah. Teach them the love of the Prophet ﷺ. You also follow the sunnah. Take this message out. Tell it to everybody. This is what our life is all about. And subhanAllah, you know, مَنْ تَمَسَّكَ بِسُنَّتِي عِنْدَ فَسَادِ أُمَّتِي فَلَهُ أَجْرُ مِيَةِ شَهِيدٍ. That whoever sticks to my sunnah in the time of the fasad of my ummah, then he will have the reward of 100 martyrs. And inshaAllah, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهِ. Allah Ta'ala will love us. وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ. Allah Ta'ala will forgive us of our sins. And that's all what we want. We sinners who have sinned day and night, all our lives, all what we want is forgiveness of our sins from Allah. And the answer is very simple. And that answer is follow the sunnah of the Prophet of Allah. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa akhiru da'wana and alhamdulillah.
سلوں کو تکلف ہے ہم سے اگر ہم بھی بے بس نہیں بے سہارا نہیں خود انہی کو پکاریں گے ہم دور سے راستے میں اگر پاؤں تھک جائیں گے جیسے ہی سبز گنبد نظر آئے گا زندگی کا قرینہ بدل جائے گا سر جھکانے کی فرصت ملے گی کسے خود ہی پلکوں سے سجدے ٹپک جائیں گے ہم مدینے میں تنہا نکل جائیں گے اور گلیوں میں قصداً بھٹک جائیں گے ہم مدینے میں تنہا نکل جائیں گے اور گلیوں میں قصداً بھٹک جائیں گے ہم وہاں جا کے واپس نہیں آئیں گے ڈھونڈتے ڈھونڈتے لوگ تھک جائیں گے نام آقا جہاں بھی لیا جائے گا ذکر ان کا جہاں بھی کیا جائے گا نور ہی نور سینوں میں بھر جائے گا ساری محفل میں جلوے لپک جائیں گے اے مدینے کے زائر خدا کے لیے
مدینے کے زائر خدا کے لیے داستانِ سفر مجھ کو یوں مت سنا اے مدینے کے زائر خدا کے لیے داستانِ سفر مجھ کو یوں مت سنا بات بڑھ جائے گی دل تڑپ جائے گا میرے محتاط آنسو چھلک جائیں گے ان کی چشم کرم کو ہے اس کی خبر کس مسافر کو ہے کتنا شوق سفر ان کی چشم کرم کو ہے اس کی خبر کس مسافر کو ہے کتنا شوق سفر ہم کو ایک بار جب ہی اجازت ملی ہم بھی آقا کے دربار تک جائیں گے فاصلوں کو تکلف ہے ہم سے اگر ہم بھی بے بس نہیں بے سہارا نہیں خود انہیں کو پکاریں گے ہم دور سے راستے میں اگر پاؤں تھک
لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم سبحان ربي العظيم على الوحيد الحمد لله رب العالمين الحمد لله رب العالمين الحمد لله رب العالمين اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم اللهم صل على سيدنا وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم جزا الله عنا سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وما هو أهله ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إنا كنا من الظالمين يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك يا مصرف القلوب صرف قلوبنا على طاعتك اللهم حبب إلينا الإيمان اللهم حبب إلينا الإيمان اللهم حبب إلينا الإيمان وزينه في قلوبنا أقر إلينا الكفر والفسوق والعصيان واجعلنا من الراشدين. اللهم آت نفوسنا تقواها وزكها أنت خير من زكاها أنت وليها ومولاها. اللهم طهر قلوبنا من النفاق وأعمالنا من الرياء ولسنتنا من الكذب وأعيننا من الخيانة فإنك تعلم خائنة الأعين وما تخفي الصدور. اللهم عنا على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك. اللهم عنا على سكرات الموت على غمرات الموت. اللهم بارك لنا في الموت وفيما بعد الموت. اللهم إنا نسألك الهدى والتقى والعفاف والغنى. اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات الأحياء منهم والأموات إنك سميع قريب مجيب الدعوات. يا أرحم الراحمين يا أكرم الأكرمين يا كريم يا غفار يا رحيم يا ودود يا وهاب يا ستار يا ستار يا ستار يا حنان يا منان يا الله. يا الله please accept this gathering from all of us. يا الله يا أرحم الراحمين please accept this gathering from all of us. And all of these beautiful people who have come, Ya Allah, for your sake, Ya Allah, with sincerity, with tarab, with ikhlas in their hearts, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, please accept this coming because of them coming in this gathering, Ya Allah. Ya Rahman Rahim, Ya Allah, with your tawfiq, Ya Allah, they have taken their time out to come and sit in this gathering of your remembrance, of your zikr, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, please accept their coming, Ya Allah, and accept this gathering from all of us. Ya Ahmar Rahmeen, Akram Al Akrameen. Ya Allah, whatever. Ya Allah, I said to you, Ya Allah, how I could not deliver the message the way it should have been delivered, Ya Allah. Ya Allah. Ya Ahmar Rahmeen. Ya Akram Al Akrameen. Ya Allah, make it the source of our forgiveness on the day of judgment, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, make it the source of the intercession of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam on the day of judgment. Make it the source of, Ya Allah, of getting, Ya Allah, water from His blessed hands on the day of judgment. Allah, make it the source of getting, Ya Allah, please, under the shade of Your throne on the day of judgment. Make it the source of, Allah, of, Ya Allah, of the expanding of our grace, of being it from the places of paradise, Ya Ahmar Rahim. Allah, making it the source that, Ya Allah, we get, Ya Allah, we are able to recite Kalima as our last words before we die, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, make it a source for your many hearts of Rahim. Make it the source of our acceptance and acceptance of everybody who is going to come unto the day of judgment from our generation. Ya Allah, make it a source, Ya Allah, of your blessings, of your rahmah, of your mercy, of your love. Ya Allah, make it a source of tawfiq, of truth, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, make it a source of, Ya Allah, that we, Ya Allah, of the, Ya Allah, increase of yaqeen, of iman in our hearts, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, we know that this is the best thing that you, Ya Allah, that you like, Ya Allah, talking about your beloved. Ya Allah, we did whatever we could, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, we did not do the way that it should have been done, Ya Arhamar Rahimeen, but you please, we beg you, Ya Allah, that you please accept it, Ya Allah. We still accept it, Ya Arhamar Rahimeen. Ya Allah, we truly are beggars at your door. You yourself have said, Ya Ayyuhannas, Antumul Fuqara'u Allah. Oh, people, we are beggars in front of Allah. Ya Allah, we are beggars. Ya Allah, we don't know anything, Ya Allah, but begging, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, we beg you at your door, Ya Allah, please accept us, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, please save us from going at any other door but your door, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, Ya Ahmar Rahim. Ya Allah, please, Ya Allah, fulfill all our needs from your door, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, all of us are here, Ya Allah, begging at your door, knocking at your door. Please open your doors of mercy, Ya Allah. Fill our hearts with your love, Ya Allah. Allah, fill our hearts with the love of your beloved, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ya Allah, give us tawfiq to follow His blessed sunnah in each and every single thing that we do, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, we don't know, we have forgotten that this is the only way of our success. Ya Allah, please open our hearts, Ya Allah. Allahumma arina al-haqqa haqqan warzuqna tiba'an. Wa arina al-batila batilan warzuqna tiba'an. Ya Ar-Rahimin, Ya Akram al-Akramin, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, we have only one hope, Ya Ar-Rahimin, Ya Allah, and that's begging at your door, Ya Allah. Please, Ya Ar-Rahimin, Ya Akram al-Akramin. Ya Allah, save us from going to any other door. Ya Allah, as you close your doors and you don't open it, Ya Allah, Shaitan will come and show us other doors, Ya Allah, but we know that we don't have any other door that we can go to, Ya Allah. Save us from the tricks of Shaitan. Ya Allah, save us, Ya Allah. Save our Iman, Ya Allah. Save the Iman of our children, Ya Allah. Allah, save the Iman of every single person who is going to come until the Day of Judgment. Ya Allah, Ya Akram al-Akramin. Ya Allah, please accept us for the service of your deen. Ya Allah, we definitely are not worthy of serving your deen, but we beg you, Ya Allah, that you accept us. We know that, Ya Allah, Ya near you, it's all about acceptance, qubuliyat, Ya Allah. You're not qabil, Ya Allah, but Ya Allah, please accept us, Ya Allah. Please, Ya Allah, give us qubuliyat, Ya Allah. Give our generation qubuliyat, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, accept every single person on the Day of Judgment to serve your deen, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, Ya Akram al-Akramin. All the people who have asked for du'as, Ya Rahimeen, you know their needs more than we do. Ya Allah, please, Ya Rahimeen, fulfill their needs from your infinite treasures. Ya Rahimeen, people who are sick physically or spiritually, give them perfect cure, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, people who are any sort of calamity, please remove those calamities from them. Ya Allah, people who are in need of anything, please fulfill their needs with khair and afiyat, Ya Rahimeen. Ya Allah, Ya Arhamar Rahimeen. Ya Allah, everybody who has any right over us, Ya Allah, we beg you that you grant all of them your true love, Ya Allah. The true love of your beloved Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Ya Allah, accept them, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, anybody, Ya Allah, Ya Arhamar Rahimeen. Ya Allah, who does adab, who shows muhabbat, Ya Allah, who love, Ya Allah. Serve your deen, Ya Arhamar Rahimeen. We beg you that you give them your special closest, Ya Arhamar Rahimeen. Ya Allah, we don't even know how to ask, Ya Allah, we beg you, Ya Allah, that you grant us all the good of this dunya, all the good of the hereafter, with khair and afiyat. Ya Allah, allow us to use our dunya for the sake of our hereafter, Ya Allah, Ya Allah, Ya Akram al-Akramin. Ya Allah, we beg you that you please make our nafs, nafsul mutma'inna, before our death, Ya Allah. With khair, with afiyat, without putting us into any sort of test, Ya Allah. We indeed are weak people, Ya Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahimeen. Ya Allah, we don't show you any strength, Ya Allah. We are the weakest of the weak, Ya Allah. Ya Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahimeen, we cannot take any test from you. We beg you that you please, Ya Allah, make our nafsul mutma'inna without any calamity, without any hardship, without any test, with khair, with afiyat. And Ya Allah, be happy with us at each and every single step that we take, each and every breath that we take, Ya Allah. And Ya Allah, protect us. Please protect us, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, please protect us, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, please protect us, Ya Allah. Please protect us, Ya Allah. Save us from all fitnas, all shurur, Ya Allah, all calamities, all hardships. Please protect us, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, please protect us and accept us, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, allow us to serve your deen at each and every corner of the world, Ya Allah. Every single person, Ya Allah, who is alive, Ya Allah. Please take these words out, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, use us, Ya Allah, to take these words out of your love, the love of your beloved, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, of His Sunnah, of Sharia, Ya Allah, of Taqwa, Ya Allah, to each and every single person of the world, Ya Allah. And Ya Allah, put effect in our words so that Ya Allah, it moves their hearts and it changes their dead hearts and gives it life again with your tawfiq, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, and give all of that reward, Ya Allah, for to all of us, Ya Allah, and to our generation, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, Ya Akram al-Akramin. put barakah in everything that we do, in our time, in our wealth, Ya Allah, in our work, Ya Allah, in our health, Ya Allah, in every single thing. Ya Allah, put barakah in everything of everybody who is going to come unto the Day of Judgment. Ya Allah, have mercy on our parents, Ya Allah. Rabbir hamhuma kama rabbayani saghira. Ya Allah, Ya Rahman Rahim, Ya Allah. It is only because of their minat, Ya Allah, their effort, Ya Allah, that we were able to recite Kalima from the time that we were born. Ya Allah, our fathers, Ya Allah, they showed us the way to the masjid, Ya Allah. Our mothers, they taught us good akhlaq. Ya Allah, it is our fault that we didn't listen to what they had to say. Ya Allah, you have mercy on them, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, guide them, Ya Allah, protect them, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, Ya Allah, our families, our friends, our students, our teachers, Ya Allah, please, Ya Allah, have mercy on all of them, Ya Allah, grant all of them the best of this dunya that we have. Ya Allah, Ya Arhamar Rahimi, Ya Allah, please give us tawfiq that we be able to recite kalima as our last word. And Ya Allah, you call us with those beautiful words of Ya Ayyatuha Nafsul Mutmainna, Irji'i ila Rabbiki Radiyatan Mardiyah, Fadkhuli fi Ibadi, Wadkhuli Jannati. Ya Allah, take our graves from the gardens of paradise. Ya Allah, save us from the punishment of the grave. Make the questions easy for us, Ya Allah. Fill it with Noor, Ya Allah, with light. Ya Allah, Ya Rahman Rahim, make it a source of our, Ya Allah, place of our rest, Ya Rahman Rahim. Ya Allah, Ya Rahman Rahim, on the Day of Judgment, please raise us in a state that you are happy with us, to give us our books in our right hand. Ya Allah, give us the shade of your throne. Ya Allah, give us the intercession of your beloved Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Allow us to follow every single sunnah, Ya Allah, so that, and serve your deen, so that when he sees us on the Day of Judgment, he smiles at us, he comes forward, hugs us, Ya Allah, intercede for us, give us water from his blessed hands, Ya Allah, make us from those fortunate people, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, please allow us to visit your blessed house again, Ya Allah. Soon, Ya Rahman. Ya Allah, allow us to visit your Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Ya Allah. Soon, Ya Allah. Allow us to be there with adab, Ya Allah, with respect, the way that we should have adab, Ya Allah. Forgive us, Ya Allah, all of our shortcomings, the lack of adab that we had the last time you allowed us to visit, Ya Allah. Please, Ya Rahman, you open ways, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, you open the ways, Ya Rahman Rahim. Please, Ya Allah, open ways for all of us, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, invite us again and again and again and again until we die, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, allow us that at its due time, Ya Allah, and whenever it's written with khair and afiyat, Ya Allah, that you allow us to die in the city of your beloved Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And Ya Allah, keep us a spirit in his neighborhood, Ya Allah, and Baqi, we are not worthy, Ya Allah. We don't want to make it filthy, Ya Allah, but we beg you that you please, Ya Allah, have mercy on us, Ya Allah. And Ya Allah, take us from those fortunate, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, all what we have asked, but we couldn't ask, Ya Allah. We beg you, Ya Allah, that you grant us all the good of this dunya and akhirah with khair and afiyat, Ya Allah. ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم وصل اللهم تعالى على خير خلقه سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين الحمد لله.